Welcome to I Drink Your Podcast, where we drink and talk about movies from 2007.
Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker!
I don't remember seeing this movie.
What's your power?
You don't got the power.
Keeps away the narwhals.
The only way to defeat a waffle is by making it a pancake.
This is one doodle that can't be undid, Holmes Gillett.
Now back to that ass.
Were you masturbating?
I drink your podcast. I drink it up.
Welcome back to another episode of I Drink Your Podcast. This week we are watching Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium, and joining me is going to be Ben. Say hello.
Hey, how's everybody doing?
That's Ben's voice, everybody. Wesley.
Hi. I also wonder how you're doing, but I know you can't talk back.
Wesley's voice, everybody. And Emily.
Hello. And we have no idea who you are. This right. Mystical voice talking yeah. to us.
Mystical host coming in last. But my name's Matt, everybody. And joining us this week is Connor from our friend of the show podcast, No Highway Option. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Hello. Thanks for having me.
Let's get started by talking about what we're drinking. Folks, I'm already a little in the bag, and I've been drinking Spindrift. What is that? This is a you've never heard of this this seltzer water? It's great. There's no alcohol in it, and it has real lime juice.
Okay. I don't have any follow up for that.
What are you drinking today, Ben?
I have a vodka Sprite Capri Sun mix because it's very whimsical, and I'm chasing it with a go-go squeeze.
Oh,
gross.
Like a go-gurt?
Mm.
No, go-go squeezes applesauce.
Okay. Oh, I don't have kids.
In a pouch.
Sorry.
Yeah.
You knew you were going to have to tell us that, right?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Great, great, great. Wesley, what are you drinking today?
I am drinking a drink called a Milo. It is gin, triple sec, simple syrup, and bitters. You're supposed to use muddled raspberries in it, but I don't have any. So I muddled clementines.
How is it?
It is not bad. Thank you, Ben.
Nice.
And for those who don't get that joke, I will definitely talk about it later.
How are muddling clementines? Did it work out okay? Okay.
It was
good to know.
The first push down, it was just gush.
Oh, okay.
All right, so there's a joke in there somewhere. But
it's a good descriptive word.
Emily, what is in your cup? What are you drinking today?
I'm drinking a passion fruit Moscow Mule because this movie is so full of passionate people with lots of passions, like hats and piano and toys
and math
and writing notes on pieces of paper instead of using your words.
And passion.
Inspiration.
Foreshadowing the episode, I see, guys. But that sounds yummy. I'd like a Moscow Mule compared to this. Okay, so Connor, what are you drinking today?
So I put together peach vodka and ginger ale, and I'm calling it a basement Bellini because it seems like a Bellini you would get if you went to a frat party in a basement.
That's awesome.
Oh, it's so good. That's way better than my attempt at being on theme with this movie.
And like 10 times better than Matt's.
Right. Yeah, it's like I wasn't even okay. Let's talk about this. So, Connor, welcome to the show. Let's talk to you and get to know you a little bit before we get started. So, this movie is from 2007, like all the movies on our show. What were you up to in 2007?
So 2007, I was 12 years old in seventh grade in New Jersey. Yeah. this was around the time I started like actually getting involved in like the school plays and musicals. It was kind of two of the worst shows we had ever done were in a row at that point. It was a play called The Adventures of a Comic Book Artist, which no one knows it exists. And it's... I don't know why someone chose it. And then Schoolhouse Rock Live Junior.
Oh, Junior.
Junior.
Yeah.
So for those who don't know, Junior productions come with like the it's a shortened version of the play. And all of the audio tracks are provided to them, so you don't need live accompaniment.
And they're usually some of the most screechy MIDI files you will ever hear.
Yes.
Yes, that is true.
But so those were happening, and I was getting into them, having more fun, trying to make more friends while being just very way too obsessive over specifically The Simpsons and Green Day. I don't know why those were the two, but
makes sense
very
to me.
Timely.
Yeah, it all worked out.
Did you just love that episode where Green Day was in The Simpsons?
Well, that's the movie which came out in 2007.
That is the movie, you're right. Yeah. Oh my God. Yes,
so like
right.
All of it kind of crested at the perfect wow. time for me.
Oh my God.
We may have to have you back for that one.
Yeah. I feel like you chose the wrong movie for him, Ben. You like, there's a Muppet in the movie. It's yeah. like 5 seconds.
Well, yeah. When you guys asked, I initially was like, oh, should I say The Simpsons movie? Because like that fits perfectly. But Matt was on our show and we have our guests choose the episode for the next show. So it's always a roulette. So I was like, I'd want to make it fair.
Yeah.
We appreciate it, but not needed. We don't need fairness here.
We really don't.
So what are some of your favorite movies then, Connor?
So my favorite movie in general, which really doesn't connect with like my favorite genres of stuff. My overall favorite is The Social Network because it, I don't know, I saw it when it came out and it just really clicked with me. But I'm mostly fans of like big dumb comedies, musicals, animated stuff. Mostly if a comedy is like dumb but it has a big heart, then I'm all in. I stand by that Tommy Boy is one of the quintessential American comedies of the 20th century. Mm-hmm. Stuff like that.
When you said your favorite movie was Social Network, I really hoped that you were going to follow that up with other movies that are all just Jesse Eisenberg movies.
They are all very similar.
That one just did not click with me. So I'm glad that some people appreciate it.
It's understandable.
I did not like it.
What, it Tommy looks Boy? Beautiful.
Oh, yes. Oh, Wesley, you know I haven't seen Tommy Boy.
Yeah.
Okay. So I guess what about Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium made you excited to be on the podcast?
Or not.
Yeah. I mean,
I was incredibly excited when I got your message saying that that's what it was, because I remember when it was coming out, just seeing the ads for it and being at the, you know, early teenager where I was like, this is definitely a movie for children. And like, this has a weird title and I'm finally knowing what a serious actor is. So why is Dustin Hoffman starring in what I guess is like Night at the Museum, but with a Toys R Us?
That's so, a good way to put it.
I would much rather see that movie.
I was always just baffled by it, and I'm glad I finally had an excuse to watch it. And plus, just from the social media circles that I follow, it has always been like, that's the thing that Kermit the Frog's in it, isn't it? Why is he there? Will I find out a reason? The answer is no.
I don't
know.
Do
you
we have
not.
A reason?
No, I desperately looked up like, okay, there are puppeteers in this. Do they have a connection to this? Are they like regular performers? There's nothing. He's just there.
There are some really weird rabbit holes that you can go down in this movie, just trying to figure things yeah. out and nothing makes sense.
Yeah, I really like the way you describe it, too. It's like it's an excuse to watch this movie because there's no other reason.
So this was your first time seeing it then?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Had anyone seen this before?
I had.
Oh, I'm sorry, Ben. Sorry you had to watch it again.
I'm not sorry
here.
At all. And here's why. Because Ben, Emily, and I actually golfed earlier this week and then hung out together and watched this movie together. Ben's snide ass sits there on the couch between the two of us, Emily and me, constantly going, ugh, ugh, ugh. Oh, and Ben just sitting there the whole time, just covering his mouth, chuckling as he knows things are going to come up and just like thriving on our pain. You, yep. you Dementor.
That's how you guys watch this
reverse
movie?
Dementor.
Yeah.
Yeah. Socially distant ish, I guess. Wow. Yeah.
Well, I hope that is foreshadowing what's to come in this
I'm excited to hear
conversation.
Connor's
yeah. Yeah, welcome aboard, Connor. I'm excited to hear what you have to say about the show. So So if you've never watched the show or if you've never listened to the show before, here's how it works. The first half of our show will be discussing and reviewing Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium. In the second half, we'll feature our Battle of Twits, a creative competition between Connor and Emily.
Woo!
Yeah, woo. Random.
Thanks for battling this week, Connor.
Yeah, I'm excited. I really listen to the show a lot at work, and every time you do Battle of the Twits, I like try to form my own answers in my head.
That's awesome.
So it'll be fun.
For anybody
to play
out there, send those in. I would love to judge your attempts at answering these questions.
Actually, that's fun. Because like we could easily find out somebody just beat us. Like, you know, 2 weeks later, whenever it comes out, and you're like, shit, that's a great idea. So,
or just send him to Matt so he can maybe start learning some better
give me
answers.
Ammo. Yeah.
Take him away.
Yeah. Don't make me have an answer like Rochambeau, 12 angry men again.
You were anyway. So excited about that answer.
Yeah. I mean,
you were so confident.
I was confident. I was like, it's his question to lose. But anyway, we are watching Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium, directed by Zach Helm, featuring Dustin Hoffman, Natalie Portman, Jason Bateman, and a child actor.
And Kermit.
And Kermit.
I'm leaving.
The store.
The world. You see these shoes? I found these in a tiny little shop in Tuscany and fell in love with them so entirely, I bought enough to last my whole life. These are my last pair.
Mr. Magorium is played by Dustin Hoffman, who's a 243-year-old owner of a magical toy store run by Mahoney, played by Natalie Portman, a failed composer, and Eric, a 9-year-old boy without any friends. Mr. Magorium hires Mutant, played by Jason Bateman, to be his accountant before he departs and leaves the store to Mahoney. As Mutant tries to organize the accounting books, he misses the magical moments in the store and is accosted by Mahoney for his disbelief in Magorium and his Wonder Emporium. The store begins to sulk and turn gray with the impending loss of Mr. Magorium.
So right off the bat, let's talk about Kermit's appearance, because he appears in this first act only.
Yeah, it's a really quick cameo where all he's doing is children are pointing and laughing at him, and he just says, "Oh, I'm shopping," like 8 times in a row.
Just shopping.
Wow. Best impression of anyone on this podcast so far. Good job.
Thank you. It's the one thing I'm good at.
Yeah, when I heard Kermit was in this movie, I figured it would be in some ironic way, or that he would show up and they would reference that he was a Muppet and in this real world, but they didn't. Like, he was just a natural part of this world that nobody really questioned.
I don't know if it was natural. The kids were laughing at him.
He's just a standard shopper in the store.
He's a frog,
and
though.
Children laugh at standard shoppers in stores? I guess I don't know.
Kids can be weird in like stores. They just look at you. I had a kid at the store I worked at yesterday pretend to fight the air, and when I walked by him, he like aggressively tried to, like, I don't know how to describe, like, the movement that you make when you're about to fight someone.
Yeah
he tried to do that to you, to like make you flinch.
Yeah, and I was like, whose parents are you? Whose child is this?
Oh my god.
But yeah, kids are like that. It's, and the timing with Kermit is weird, because this is the first time he's been in a movie since 1999 at this point.
Oh, seriously? This is like when he just randomly shows up?
Yeah, it's
what the hell?
It's 3 years after Disney bought them, and like 2 years after they did the Wizard of Oz TV movie that everybody hates.
Yes,
so
agreed.
There's no reason for him to be here. It's very confusing.
I mean, Kermit's always in the zeitgeist.
True.
No, that's absolutely true.
I have no follow up. That's just fact.
Yeah. Like, why it's specifically that zeitgeist? I don't know. Talking about kids, like, I couldn't stand working in this toy shop. None of these kids bought anything. They just played all around, you know? Like, how does this business make any money? Sorry.
The parents were buying shit, weren't they? I mean, there was that one lady that went up to Mahoney and she had the big book and the fire truck. And she's like, oh, I want a fire truck. That right. lady bought that. So it must be just the parents.
That's
and then there's
true.
That weird fish mobile. Mobile.
Yeah,
that,
yeah,
that, yeah.
That was $50 or something. The one that's real and the one that's not, and it's made out of fish sticks.
I'm kind of ashamed at how hard I laughed at that reveal. I really I just like expected poorly drawn fish, and when it was fish sticks, I'm like, okay, you got me once.
This beginning of the movie does have a lot of fun, interesting ideas, like the big book, like the door of rooms, Bellini, the bookmaker. Like they introduce a lot of whimsical, fun stuff in this beginning.
Right. But speaking of the door of rooms, they totally stole that from Howl's Moving Castle. I was really pissed about that.
Oh, yeah.
I know. Thank you. I'm glad someone knows what I'm talking about. We need more people like you on the show, Connor. Thank you.
Connor's just lying over there. He's never seen it. He's just like, oh,
it's been a long time, but that's definitely a small visual that's in my head now.
Right, right. But seriously, in this beginning, I loved the opening credits of this animation with like the paper style. I was like, oh, this is kind of interesting and quirky. It kind of makes me think that maybe I will like what's coming up next. But then the little kid starts to narrate.
But then the movie starts.
Everything went downhill, and I was just really depressed about that. I thought I would like it based off of the opening, because like I liked the music coming in, I liked all the animation, and then this kid starts talking, and it's not even like he's that bad with the narration. It was the dialogue itself that sucked so bad. For example, he's like randomly talking and introducing Bellini, and he talks about, yes, he sleeps with a dolly. And I'm like, oh, children talk like that. Yep. Yes, they talk like that. And then he starts talking about how Mr. Magorium did things for Abraham Lincoln, beat him in hopscotch or something, and he made toys for Napoleon, and he has the record being upside down. I'm like, what do any of these things have to do with anything? Like, you're not showing anything, introducing, like, the narration didn't match with what was happening, and they were showing. I hated it.
And don't forget the most important one. Someone in Detroit once called him Steve.
Steve, yes.
So I just remembered the joke that Emily came up with. I don't know when. It's probably more appropriate at the end of the episode, but I'm glad we brought
that
up. Yeah,
way to bring it up now, Wesley.
Hey, it'll be funny for everybody else.
I don't know. It wasn't
little
that
teaser.
Funny.
So the reason that I was so bothered by everything you just listed was because you're right. There's no grounding for it. It's wacky for the sake of being wacky. And I don't know if any of you watch the TV show Community, but yeah. I spent the first good amount of time trying to figure out who the hell is this movie for. And if you guys remember the episode of Community where Abed goes on two dates at once, and he has to keep switching back and forth between the Christian girl that
Shirley,
thank you,
set him up with,
and this quirky girl that Alison Brie's character set him up with.
Annie,
thank you. Obviously, I watched the show so much. But the girl that Annie sets him up with is like, is this movie condensed into one side plot character, like scene for scene? And it just drove me nuts the entire time. I don't know if you guys felt any less upset than I did. That was a question. Sorry.
Just like the ravings of a madman. Like this movie was bad. And, that made me upset. And I feel like my biggest problem was like Natalie Portman's character seemed to flip flop like between like just like that side character person, like just airhead crazy, like, oh, you don't believe in magic, to like realistic at home, like with their little concerto she was composing. I think those are music words. Like she seemed to flip flop a lot, and she wasn't like a real character to me. Dustin Hoffman was just reprising Rain Man, it felt like.
Haven't seen Rain Man either, so I don't even know what that means. Can someone try to explain that to me, Matt?
He's autistic.
He's autistic, and he does like a similar accent.
No.
Oh God.
No, he doesn't.
Accent has never been done before.
I think Zach Helm, who wrote and directed this movie, I think he saw Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, the Tim Burton one, and was like, I can make something whimsical like that. Because it does have that very much whimsy for whimsy's sake, where like Mr. Magorium is kind of like a Johnny Depp Willy Wonka, where he just kind of is quirky and says random things that are funny to someone, maybe.
But aren't.
It's a possibility.
But aren't, yeah.
It's also, they treat Mr. Magorium like it's like he's 243 years old, he has a magic toy shop, you get it. Like, it's a character that we're all supposed to already know. Like, it's similar characters like Mary Poppins. It's like, oh, Mary Poppins has done all this cool stuff, but you're introduced to her as like a nanny, and then bit by bit it's like, oh, she's more and more magical. This is just like, funny eyebrow man has done everything,
right?
But you're not gonna see him first. We're focusing on the mute Russian acrobat who lives in his basement and is his biographer.
Was born in his basement.
Yeah. That's a really good point, Connor. I couldn't figure out a way to express that. I was so confused with the narration. It had nothing to do with what was actually happening. Yes, you were just all about Bellini in the basement. And I'm like, what the fuck is happening? You know, if they had done something with like the books opening and showing like these pictures of it, like even that would kind of link the narration and what we were seeing on screen. But I think, Ben, you said that Zach Helm, this is his first directorial debut or whatever. I think this is his first movie that he actually directed.
I think it's his first directing. I think he wrote something before this, though.
He wrote Stranger Than Fiction before this.
That's right. Which made me think, like, how did he go from writing that like phenomenal script to this?
So are he and Dustin Hoffman like related then? Because that's two Dustin Hoffman movies he's involved in.
That's true.
I don't know, but I do know that Natalie Portman really wanted to be in this movie. There are interviews of her saying, yeah, she read the script and she just knew she had to be in this. And I am just appalled by that.
I don't really have words. I just don't get it.
No, there were a lot of really important people in this movie, like being a part of this movie, specifically the music. The music was by Alexander Desplat. I don't know how to say French last names, but we'll go Desplat.
I think that's right.
And then Aaron Zygmunt, who's an American. But Desplat did Grand Budapest Hotel and The Shape of Water and won Academy Awards for both of those. And so, like, I personally thought the music in this was charming and it fit with the characters and this idea of Mahoney, Natalie Portman's character, her playing piano in the air. I thought that was a really cool, nuanced idea of just like hearing the notes sporadically. She actually learned piano for this role, so she really took this seriously, I guess. But I don't know. It just reminded me a little bit of the Cloud Atlas sextet. You know, just, I know obviously it was before Cloud Atlas, but this idea of this piece of music kind of having themes throughout the movie really kept me going through it. You know, nothing else about this movie besides the music made me really feel anything except horror.
There's a lot of separate ideas in this that just have no narrative glue to hold any of it together. Like, it's a lot of interesting ideas and interesting actors doing interesting things, but there's no movie around it. It's like they we'll have a cube that's wooden that magically spins around. But then like it doesn't do anything other than be magical. Same with the door of rooms. It's like, we'll have a door that has many rooms that you turn a knob and it changes between them. But the door never like had anything to do with the plot. It was just there.
We'll have a kid that wears a different hat every single day.
Do you remember that huge dodgeball?
The huge dodgeball.
Yeah. It's hard to dodge.
Impossible, even though physics would allow you to slip under most of the curve.
I just kept thinking, if they change the door dial while you're in the room, are you stuck there? Is there a door out?
Well, that's how Howl's Moving Castle works. So
does the room go away?
How many children have been lost?
The correct
amount.
That's
a good point.
What happens to those children? Does Bellini get them? Is that what Bellini eats?
Do they become the toys?
The rest of the podcast. I just want to talk about what happens to kids that get lost in this door.
That's why that sock monkey is always trying to grab Jason Bateman. It wants him to take him out.
Oh my!
The kids, God. Kids become the spirit of the magical toys.
He claims he owns a magical toy store.
I do. You work there.
And that he's 242 years old and an inventor.
I am not 242 years old. I'm 243. You were at my birthday party. You brought me balloons.
Yeah, he's delusional. He may have had a stroke.
Eric the Hat Man, the child, makes friends with Mutant, the accountant, and the store starts to attack the shoppers unbeknownst to Mutant. Mr. Magorium closes the store and tells Mahoney he is departing. She interprets it as he's sick and dying and checks him into the hospital, even though the doctors can't find anything wrong with him. While Mahoney attempts to prevent Mr. Magorium from leaving by showing him the joys of life, Mutant walks Eric home and then they play with his hats. Jason Bateman's playing with a child in his room unsupervised, and then the mom catches them.
For some reason, Jason Bateman's doing like the perfect Monty Python woman voice.
Yeah. Yes.
Was he like playing a goblin or something?
Yeah, he was supposed to be a goblin.
The one thing that I actually really liked about this act was his character that he came up with and like his voice. I thought that was really funny. And I'm like, oh, okay, you're actually like into this like persona and make believe. That's kind of cute. Although it was fucking creepy that, you know, he's playing with a 9-year-old boy unsupervised and mom doesn't know who he is. And
yeah. Chill, dude. He's my friend. Like, oh, okay. Okay, little 8-year-old boy.
And she doesn't, like, do anything. She's just like, oh, okay. And then Jason Bateman just leaves.
Remember when I specifically said, try to make friends your own age? This isn't that, bud.
Yeah, me and Shelby were watching it. And during that, them writing on the little notepads between the window, they're communicating, writing on notepads back and forth.
Oh, with the Cat Stevens playing?
Yeah, me and Shelby really wrote, like, it is inappropriate for me to be talking to you. And this is like pointing at it.
It's also just the You Belong With Me Taylor Swift music video.
Oh,
I forgot about yeah. that.
That's exact same thing.
I scrubbed that from my brain.
Just thinking about what we were talking about earlier, I really think this movie would have been a better horror movie.
Definitely.
You know, we've got this whole creepy mutant character that like stalks children, and there are all these children everywhere and the store is attacking them. Like, I decided to write down everything that goes wrong at the store that I could actually see. Yes, I watched part of this movie again. Don't judge me.
I also think Mr. Magorium is kind of like weird for being in the toy business. You know? I wouldn't trust him with my kids, you know, that place. I don't want to go too far down that line.
Here's the thing. He's standing there watching all of this happen. There's a guy that's like gets tangled in yo-yos with his arms that look dislocated. Honestly, there's a breathing dragon. There's the lemur from The Big Book that's like attacking a child. There's when the doors open and like release all the trains and hula hoops and balls and they attack everyone. There are all of these flying airplanes that are dive bombing people. There is that one lady that opens a book and has a squid on her head. You know, the shelves are breaking and they're glass. You know, all I was thinking about is, wow, if my children were here, they would not survive, I don't think. And or at least someone would get hurt and someone would be suing this place. But everything's hunky-dory, I guess.
I felt the same way when everything started to turn black, like the ash started appearing on the wall and then like started to turn red. I was like very optimistic for a little bit that this movie was gonna turn. And I was like, oh, we are about to see some the upside down or something here with some terrible stuff. But no.
And yeah, he's just a grump at the dirty wall.
He just stopped sulking.
You know, the magic store is throwing a temper tantrum because the store feels emotions and love for Mr. Magorium.
Sure. Well, we'll get to it later. But some of these toys have functions that they should not have as a toy. So imposing feelings in a building, I don't know, it doesn't seem that far-fetched for the whole, for the world we're supposed to be living in here.
True. Also, I understand like the generic toys being magic, but I was very surprised whenever they would be like, oh, here's a branded toy that's like an obvious thing. It's magic now. And I'm like, but why isn't it magic at like the store down the street?
Oh, yeah.
What's he doing? Like how's he making this work?
Yeah.
Right. Why were things magic in the store? Like, was Mr. Magorium himself magic? Or was it just the store that was magic? because then the kids go home and they're like, oh shit, my thing doesn't do anything now. I don't know why it's a thing.
I'm fairly certain this movie was not that well thought out, that they had reason behind what they were doing.
I want to stick with the theory that the toys and the store are magic because of the souls that are inhabiting the rooms that are no longer there.
Oh, snap, Wesley! The kids that are lost forever, their lost souls find their way back into their toes.
The sock monkey was Jason Bateman's former little brother.
Oh, shit.
And that's why he wanted to hug him.
See, we can make this movie good. We can make this movie good.
And see, and because he was lost in the rooms, that's why Bateman doesn't have a sense of wonder.
So here's another connection. It's the lost boys because Dustin Hoffman plays Hook.
There you go.
I don't know if I'm impressed with us or this is dumb.
This is dumb. We should move on.
It's a little dumb. And the store can create life because when Mr. Magorium's turning the knob to go to the different rooms, he's like, oh no, now it's the cheerleader room. Now it's this room. Where are they coming from? Who is? I had too many questions for something that was 90 minutes long.
Thank God it wasn't longer.
Yeah.
Okay, can we talk about how this was a G-rated movie for how insane it was?
Yeah, we can.
Well, sure, man. Do you have a point related to that that you'd like to make?
I was just kind of, you know what they say is like setting you up. you know, putting the ball up
Matt,
in the
you
air.
Did a good job. I wrote this in there and I thought it was funny to watch it crumble.
like, who are you hurting?
So I just thought it was interesting that there's a death in this G-rated movie. Like, I think that that's a pretty high concept that, you know, I don't know how you guys would choose to raise your children, but I feel like a G-rated movie, that's a pretty heavy subject. And I know that there are others like that. Can you guys think of other G-rated movies with deaths?
I'm going to be honest.
Bambi, Lion King.
Yep.
I don't really pay attention to that kind of thing.
So
Bambi was the only one I can think of as well.
That was the first one to pop in my head.
And Lion King, they actually, when they just released the live action, is now rated PG. And so one of the things I found interesting when I started looking for kind of traumatic things in G-rated movies or that kind of thing, the industry has really kind of turned its back on G-rated movies. They really don't make G-rated movies anymore. And some of the stuff I was reading was speculating that it's not about the ratings board and it's not about the actual content. It's more so that the movies themselves have a better protection for parents who, if they make the movie PG-13 versus G, the accountability of knowing what your child is seeing is on the parents way more than the movie company for putting out a G-rated movie. I thought that was really interesting. But like, if you look back at the last 5 years, the number of G-rated movies outside of documentaries is like shockingly low. I just had never thought about that before.
I do think also that with the move for kids movies to try to incorporate something for adults into them, that it kind of loses that ability to even be G. Like Shrek was really the first kids movie I can remember that really tried to like hammer home an adult audience also and be relatable in that way. I think it's just more that as you try to appeal to adults, you lose the ability to call yourself a G movie.
When you were talking, Ben, I was thinking the adult themes of death and the adult themes of just like having stuff in there for adults too. I think that's actually important for kids to have that experience and have those discussions with parents too, to actually have good conversations and learning lessons from them. So having just G-rated movies where you can just be brain dead when you stare at them, it's pointless.
I feel like so many G-rated things don't come out because they don't make as much money as like, I don't know, if you're like 10, you see something's PG versus G, G's like, that's the baby movie. I'm going to see the PG thing because there might be a swear. So that might make more money. Maybe that's
why
they
don't. Ben, you have a child. What do you think?
That's an interesting point because I was trying to apply that what you just said, Connor, to my daughter. And I don't think she's aware of the rating systems at all. I think she just sees the trailer and it's like, oh, I find that content interesting. I want to watch Upside Down Magic on Disney Channel. And I don't care what it's rated. By the way, do not watch Upside Down Magic. It's not good.
Yeah, I've watched a couple movies with your daughter that are subpar.
Yeah.
Your life is an occasion. Rise to it.
Mahoney returns to the store with Mr. Magorium. He uses stage notes of Shakespeare's King Lear to make a point about the natural simplicity of death before dying himself. Believing herself to be incapable of running the store, Mahoney puts it up for sale, and then it loses all of its magic. Mutant meets Mahoney to draw up the sales paper when she confesses her complete faith in the store. The Congreve cube flies around the store. That's the big wooden cube that does nothing. And after witnessing this, Henry faints with shock, but then Mahoney tells him it was all a dream to get him to admit that he believes in the store true. The store returns to its former glory with her as her confidence builds.
So I put a Henry in this part because there's like one or two times where Eric, the kid with all the hats, calls him Henry instead of mutant. And I was like, I'll just put one Henry in there.
I also like that the title of mutant in just the written outline here has lost the quotation marks around it. Now it is just officially he is a mutant.
This is who he is.
He is a mutant. And that comes from what? He's a counter and
a mix between a counter and a mutant. He's an accountant, which is a mix between a counter and a mutant.
Right. Yeah, I still don't get that joke. I had to write it out. When it's you actually see joke, the right? letters, and when you see the letters, it's like, oh, okay, this works right. on paper. It does not work on sound. Cool.
Yeah,
good job.
A lot of Natalie Portman's jokes towards him were just like terrible jokes where he didn't have to laugh, and she's like, "That was a joke, you fucking loser piece of shit. Lighten up." And he'd be like, "Maybe be funnier, Natalie Portman."
There were super awkward spaces too. Just like they're talking to each other, and then there's just this silence that just yeah. goes on way too long. All of these weird mm-hmm. things that this director does, I don't understand.
I was very confused by the ending. The part where Henry faints and then we come back and Mahoney, I'm reading the plot summary and that's for some reason not what I thought happened, where you said Mahoney tells him it was a dream to get him to admit that he believes in the store. I thought that's what she was doing because it seemed like she was trying to goad him and make like give him a hard time. But then after he does admit that it's magic, she still is like skeptical that it's magic. Like it was very confusing.
She never admits to it actually being there with him. So like, was that right. a dream?
So she never admits it. And like, she gets him to be like, you do believe in magic. It is magic. And then suddenly she has the magic herself when she's conducting the imaginary concerto right. to bring everything back to life.
I love all the up talking there. That was the yep. perfect way to discuss this movie.
I wrote this based off of the Wikipedia description, which it's funny when I was reading through it at the top, it said this article might have many errors or is too long. Can you edit it? I'm like, oh, shit, I don't know about this because I was confused, too. I didn't know what happened. And so I did my own interpretation because I felt that Mahoney lied to him about it being a dream just so that she could convince him to believe in it too. And she had never actually admitted, and this was not obvious, she had never admitted in the store that she believed in the store. It was outside of the store when he was sitting on a bench when she actually was like, the store's magic and you're a just a guy.
So I agree with you, and I think that was the intent, because the title of the chapter of this is Messing with the Mutant. So it's her messing with that him too, to try yeah. to get him to admit it. But nothing in the way that Natalie Portman's character was acting told me that she like was ever a joke. Like she almost played it too straight to yeah, the point no where gotcha. I didn't get it as an adult. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's just the only way to interpret it to make any sense. If she really wasn't there. Yeah, it's
then there
it's
was no point
ending.
To the cube.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I mean, we can talk about that more if we want, but. When you said you were confused by the ending, I thought you were talking about my favorite part of the movie, which came after the credits. So if anybody...
Oh, I don't remember. We saw it. I don't remember.
Yeah. So as you're watching the credits, another fun fact, all of the actors and actresses in this movie, their character names come in a format of name, comma, the blank, 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 describing what they basically did in the movie. So they were like the boy who was in the store, the woman with the octopus on her head, the woman who wanted to buy the mobile. And pretty far down the list was a character named, and this is going to bring us all back, so you're welcome on this callback to the name of my drink. There's a character in this movie named Milo, and it was Milo, comma, who's not bad. Now that vagueness.
Oh, that's right.
I was like, because as I was reading some of these, they're hilarious. I highly recommend going to read these. I was reading these out loud to Emily and Ben, and they're going like, oh, yeah, I know who that was. I know exactly who that was. I know who that was. And none of us, I don't think, could remember Milo, who's not right. bad. I was like, I don't understand what that means. So we're going through because the end credits were, you know, they had some visual funness and I enjoyed reading the name. So I actually did sit and watch all the way through it. And it gets to the end of the credits and it pops up with Mr. Magorium painting on the wall, that big portrait. And he just, there's no talking until he turns to a kid who's just been standing next to his ladder. And he goes, what do you think, Milo? And he goes, not bad. And that's why I'm drinking a Milo.
And because of that not bad comment, Milo forever remains hidden beyond the doors.
I do think that having character names along with a description of what they did in the movie, though, is helpful because how many times have you watched a movie and seen a character's name and then not have any idea who that person was in the movie?
So that was the right. best part of the movie?
The I think it was very well thought out, especially for a kid's movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Only well thought out part of this movie because, yeah. for example, they don't do anything with these secondary plot points. For example, Mahoney's Concerto just doesn't finish.
Yeah, she's a toy store owner now. That's Yay. Her. That's her. This is her passion, life. Not piano.
Eric is friends with two adults and no kids his age.
Yeah, but he's learned how to put himself out there. That's the whole point. He's learned that by holding up signs, he can get people to like him.
This seems like a recipe for disaster.
Although I will say the one B plot that made me a little bit happy, and I think this is Ben's favorite part, the sock monkey finally gets to hug Mutant. So I guess it's worth it.
That's probably the closest this movie comes to a horror movie when all of the sock animals like pull him in and are like clawing at him.
Slowly converging on Jason Bateman. I mean, I think the whole thing with all of the secondary plot points all come into the one thing that I think Mahoney says at the end, that it's just all about believing in yourself, not even in the store, not in this. It's just believing in yourself. And like she needs that for a concerto. Eric needs that for kids his own age.
Yeah, I figured it was just to set up a sequel.
Oh snap. Wesley was talking to me. Wesley, please enlighten Ben.
So as I was doing a little bit of prep here, it came up with Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium 2. And boy, let me tell you, did I get excited.
So
I searched for it. And unfortunately, Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium has such high SEO that Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium 2 seemed to be pretty buried for what I thought. But what it turns out is that it's just a 2016 fantasy comedy film made in Canada. And the only thing
real?
I love having you guys on the line right now. This is amazing. So after doing as much research as I could, this only exists on a wiki page, not the real Wikipedia, a fandom page that is a dream for a sequel where they cast out everybody in the movie and it has somebody playing Mahoney's great, great grandson. It has Mr. Magorium still in the cast. It has like all these, it's just a dream cast list of people to play roles that are terribly underdefined other than just like, he's the friend of this guy. He also works at the shop and that's about it. I'm glad I got you guys on the hook there for just a little bit, because that's exactly how I felt when I saw Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium 2 for the first time. I was like, oh my God, I must know more. And now you can all be disappointed just like I am that it doesn't actually exist.
I guess Natalie Portman didn't have to be in that one.
No.
Well, and I never thought they'd have a sequel based on how hated this movie is by the director.
Right. Yeah. Say more about that.
True.
The director, in an interview after this movie came out, basically disowned the film, saying like, and I don't know how you can do this when you're the writer and director and are the, like, the main creative behind it, like to be like, oh, that was shit. And it's everyone's fault but mine. But that's what he tried to do. So Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium showed up in one of the last episodes of Breaking Bad. When Walter White is stuck in this cabin, the only form of entertainment he has is two DVDs of Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium. And when the director of Wonder Emporium was asked about that, he said, that's two more DVDs than that are allowed in my house.
Maybe that's the Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium too.
The two of them. I mean, he even kind of started disowning it before the movie started. Because if you look at the opening credits, a film by Zach Mills, right above it, there's like a little graphic that says supposedly.
That's right. I thought that was like a joke of like, haha, this is funny. But now looking back on that, oh my gosh, Connor. I didn't even think of that.
Well, and I think that maybe that supposedly shows up, and maybe there was a lot of intervention by the studio or producers in this that kind of muddled his vision, because that's the only thing I can see that would cause him to say, I'm disowning this film, as if it wasn't his vision.
Giving him the benefit of the doubt.
Maybe I want the Zach Helm cut of Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium.
Yeah, no, who knows?
Fuck the Snyder cut of Justice League. Give me the Zach Helm cut of Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium.
Give me 4 whole hours of the Wonder Emporium.
Okay. This is my favorite part of the show, where I'm just going to rapid fire list some stream of thought notes that I had while watching this movie.
These are just a few of our incredible thoughts.
What the fuck is in the hoops room? It was hoops. Why would he make toys who have to go to the bathroom? And why does a toy porta potty flush?
I didn't even see that. What?
Yeah. So again, in reference to what I was talking about earlier with whatever this magic is that gives these toys extra, when we're first going through the store, we see a set of construction figures and they're on a job site and one of them goes into a porta potty and then it flushes. And we'll move on from there.
A lot of questions to be answered.
Wearing hats is not a personality trait. I know from experience. And last but not least, I don't even know how to find out, but I really want to know, what is the hat budget of this movie?
Yeah, seriously.
That was some of the most exciting parts of the movie, was figuring out what his next hat was going to be.
Was it?
That's what I enjoyed most. It was like, you know, he's coming back with a new hat. What's it going to be? What is he going to culturally appropriate this time?
Right. Seriously.
There were a couple times where the hat change wasn't drastic enough. It was like a beige fedora to like a slightly less beige fedora.
Yeah. It would go from like a straw hat to like those Italian boat hats or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So here's my dad joke this week. Dad joke. When Eric is standing at the foot of the bed of Mr. Magorium, pulling out the stuff he got in the hospital gift shop, he pulls out an instrument. And when he pulls it out, I thought, is that a tuba? And then I immediately said, it's not a tuba.
It was funny in person. He actually did say that when we watched the movie.
I'll be honest, I don't get it. I'm sorry, Ben.
It was really hard for me to be creative this week.
the kid pulled out some instrument that was called like a euphonium. Yeah.
A euphonium? Yeah.
All right. So here's my rant.
I have a microphone and you don't.
So you will listen to every damn word I have to say!
I thought that this movie could have been good. When I was listening to another podcast, Who Shot Ya? I think his name was Ricky. He was talking about Cloud Atlas and other movies that they loved that other people hated. And he actually loved this movie. And I'm like, you know what? If I changed a bunch of things, I think I would actually like this movie a lot more. I like the premise of it. It's a magical toy store run on belief. I like the music part of it. I like all the different silly, whimsical things. But there needs to be a lot of changes. For example, number one, the first thing that needs to change is the dialogue. The kids need to have believable dialogue. They have shit for dialogue. For example, one of the things a kid says is, it's strangely weird and weirdly strange. No kid is going to fucking say that. Adults should also have that believable dialogue. Natalie Portman's jokes and Hoffman's lines, they fell flat, but not always because of the acting. It was because of the lines. The second thing that should have changed is, you know, Mr. Magorium should have actually died for real. Make it meaningful and memorable and have stakes in this movie.
Are you talking like a gunshot or something?
Yeah, you want him hanging from the rafters of the Wonder Emporium?
No, I want him to be like actually sick or something, you know? I don't want
Instead
him to be
just
like
fading into the stars.
We just don't even know where he goes. He just disappears. And
no, he doesn't. He doesn't even disappear.
Oh, yeah, we don't even just see, like, his shoes left behind or something. Mm. But I thought it could be nice, you know, Eric could be, like, the son of Mutant and Mahoney. Speaking of Eric, let's just get fucking rid of him in the actual movie because he doesn't add anything to the movie.
Hats.
His subplot does not do anything. And as cheesy as it is, I felt like a Mahoney-Mutant romance would actually drive some plot forward. Because then they would be like, oh, we're going to run the store together kind of thing. And then the last thing that I think would have helped this movie is that the music saves the store. Mahoney learns from herself. She finishes her concerto and she needs to run the store differently from Magorium by using music. So I just felt like there were a lot of interesting components. They just executed it terribly. End of rant. Connor, what did you think of this movie?
Real quick, you mentioned how Mr. Magorium should have actually died. I can't stop thinking about, like, it's my time to go. It's going to be a brain hemorrhage in about 45 minutes. But so overall, while the entire movie is sweet and ultimately harmless, it's a little too whimsical for its own good. The actors do fine, but they seem confused a lot of the time, as if they're being directed by a Mr. Magorium type who's purposefully vague for the sense of whimsy. And the ultimate lesson that it ends on is probably the biggest film cliche of all time. If I wanted something with nice music to yell at me to believe, I would listen to that Josh Groban song from Polar Express for an hour and a half.
Wow.
I give it 6 Brazilian doorknobs, which sounds like a sex thing, out of 12.
Bravo.
Phenomenal.
Bravo.
Wow. Thank you.
So, Connor, you're the guest. Would you prefer odds or evens?
I'll take odds.
It is a 4, so Ben is going to get to pick first.
Ben's not playing. Why are you letting Ben pick first?
It is a 4, so
Ben, it's all you now. You got to do it all from scratch.
I can try.
Oh man, that would be fun if we just threw in a third person that didn't know you were going to do it. All right. So for question 1, I'm going to give you 6 movies to pick from. Your options are Requiem for a Dream, The Shape of Water, The Martian, This is the End, Shaun of the Dead, or Marley and Me.
I'm going to go with Shaun of the Dead.
Awesome. And Connor, would you like me to read them again?
I think I'll go with This is the End.
Going with End of the World movies.
Yeah.
And now, for the love of mustard, it's time to play Battle of the Wonder Twits. I will pose 3 rounds of questions for our guests today and let them try to convince me who should inherit the magic store. And after, I will decide who has worn through their last pair of shoes. The winner of each round will get 1 Magorium. Second place gets 0 Emporium. I will be more easily whisked away by the more zany and quirky answers. Just kidding. Please be creative. After the new toy monger cracks the wood cube puzzle, they will. And here's the thing, guys, we didn't come up with a punishment.
They're both free rolling today. There is no punishment.
Yeah.
Just have a good clean fight.
The punishment was watching this movie. So
that was enough.
We all suffered.
All right, so slap doodles, are you ready?
Heck yeah.
Connor, do you have any questions?
No, I'm ready to do this.
All right. Well, let's get right into Wesley's random question, which truly feels like an appropriately named question for this movie. So for the chosen movie that you were just given, I want you to describe the cameo that Kermit the Frog makes. And we are going to start out with Emily, who chose Shaun of the Dead.
Yeah. What's wrong, David? Never taken a shortcut before. Shaun attempts his leap over the fence and fails. When he stands up and looks around, he sees a frantic Kermit glancing behind him, shouting and flailing his arms. A zombie puppeteer with a disgruntled-looking Miss Piggy on his hand is slowly following him, step by step. Miss Piggy's curls are bloodied and muddy. Her dress is torn, she's missing an eye, and the puppeteer is making an attempt to grunt like a pig. Kermit waves at the group and then says to Shaun on the ground, "Hi-ho, just because you haven't found your talent yet doesn't mean you don't have one." Then he leaps effortlessly over the fence and hops away. Zombie puppeteer Piggy only has eyes for Kermit, while the group shrug and continue on their way to the Winchester.
Very nice. Very nice. All right, Connor, and you picked This Is the End.
Okay, so this would be happening when Jay Baruchel and Craig Robinson, of course, playing themselves, leave their house to go and get supplies from a different abandoned house. On their way, they walk by a large, lavish mansion, and we see a small shadow just looking out the window, following them to the next house. Cut back, everything's normal. They're at the next house when they hear small clatter and some noises. They turn around and it's Kermit the Frog. He's like, "There are other survivors. Oh, thank God. Listen, I think we should all band together. My house has enough room for everybody and everything will work out great." And Craig and Jay look at each other and look at the demon dog that's been stalking them and have the thought, it's a demon dog, but it's still a dog. Jay Baruchel grabs Kermit as Craig screams, "Throw the squeaky toy." And they throw Kermit into the jaws of the demon dog as a distraction to escape.
That's amazing.
I know it's not part of it, but I do think that with Jason Segel's connection to those guys that made This Is the End, that they could probably get Kermit in that movie.
Probably. Oh, they probably could. Oh, that's funny. Oh, shit.
All right. Now, Mr. M has been around for a long time, 243 years. So dude's got to have a pretty awesome stash of assets. In his will, I want you to read about just three of those items and who he is bequeathing them to. And for this one, we're going to start with you, Connor.
Okay. So Mr. Magorium creating his will. "I, Edward Shablagoo Magorium, being of sound mind and body, shall depart from this mortal plane on redacted 2007 at 4:30 p.m. This is my last will and testament. To the mutant, I leave you all of my material debts and, of course, a nail file. You're going to need the nail file when the IRS finally catches up to you. To Nick Merigioli, CEO of Oscar Mayer Wieners, I leave you my pet zebra Mortimer. He may be a stupid zebra, but he will eat your extra hot dog, so there's no more issue with an uneven ratio of hot dogs to buns.
Oh my God.
P.S. Please don't turn him into a hot dog. I'll know. Now, I'll know. And finally, last but not least, to Bellini, I leave you, of course, the key. You're finally free. But be aware, while it frees you from the store, you'll never be free of me, no matter how hard you try."
Wow. My face is really tight right now. Okay, Emily.
All right. An excerpt from Mr. Magorium's will recording. "I, not Steve Magorium, residing in my own Wonder Emporium, New York, declare this to be my will, and I revoke any and all wills I previously made." Sounds of tape player fast forwarding. "And on to Article 3, to my dearest and most faithful friends. To my closest companion, Mortimer, I give you this euphonium. My only dream is for you to play it better than I ever could. I think your hooves will definitely give you an advantage. Oh, a zebra playing a tuba? Now that would be a most ingenious toy. Mahoney, make this happen." "To my inspiration and most delectable aficionado, Willard P. Wonka, I give you all my doodles I never framed. I hope they help you find your own successor. I especially like my chocolate amusement park doodle with tickets you can eat. And to my better self, with significantly better eyebrows, Captain Hook, to you I give all the clocks from the store I visited with Mahoney. Yes, I did buy them all. And yes, my last wish is for you to smash them all into oblivion with your heart's content. I will miss you most of all. Sir, I can't put a forehead kiss into your will recording. Why not? Because it's impossible. You just have to believe. That's not how it works, sir. Well, Flapdoodle, just kiss him in person then.
That was a full experience.
It was a full experience.
Awesome answers so far. So, third and final question. Where did Mr. Magorium go?
No flavor text.
So
no flavor text. Generic. Didn't need it.
All right.
What more could you say? So, Emily, where did Mr. Magorium go?
As Mr. Magorium is sitting in the store preparing to go, the room dissolves and turns into the starry night. At this time, he is transported into space, since he is indeed a Time Lord. Floating around without shoes to remain human, his next adventure in life will need to be one where shoes aren't necessary, although they will be encouraged. When Mr. Magorium opens his eyes next, he will be surrounded by a multitude of bright yellows and oranges. And then he'll hear the buzz. As the haziness of space and time travel clears, his eyes widen in horror. I didn't really mean what I said about my next life being a bee, he buzzes. Yes, Mr. Magorium is now a bee in a hive in New York's Central Park. Although this is not the New York he knows. Everything is distorted and colorful and animated. Mr. Magorium assumes... Mr. Magorium assumes the persona of Frankie. But after 12 days of this life, he just can't take it anymore and he decides he needs to move on to his next one. Therefore, he sneaks out with the pollen jocks and heads right for an unsuspecting squirrel, ready to end his miserable existence with a sting. Why, yes, Frankie was the B&B movie that stung a squirrel in the beginning of the movie. And yes, I did just save you from ridiculous bee puns. You're welcome.
And see, this is why I don't have any follow-up questions, because you answer them already. So, Connor, where did Mr. Magorium go?
So, Mr. Magorium has spent presumably at least one century entertaining children of all ages, so it's time he gets some entertainment for himself. As he fades away into a starfield, he wakes up in a magical place. It's full of color and music and wonder. There's jewelry hanging from the trees. There's a king welcoming everybody with a parade. It's this wonderful place called New Orleans. Specifically during Mardi Gras, but Mr. Magorium is now stuck on Bourbon Street.
Wow.
Like as a newborn?
No, just as him.
he didn't die. He just flat out left.
Teleported.
Like, I'm going to New Orleans, fuckers.
Pretty much, yeah. He's got no shoes now, which is, you know.
Okay.
But he's still got his, you know, wacky suit, the big eyebrows, and colorful socks.
Is he drinking?
This is when he learns how to drink, so yes.
Okay. Oh, boy.
Wow. Starting at the ripe age of 243.
That's in a few sequel. Years, when he turns 260, he finally realizes that he feels empty without the store. So it's time for him to create something new. But now that he's been in New Orleans long enough, he this is all just coming to me right now. He isn't much a fan of entertaining children anymore. So he somehow gets a magic plot of land and creates Mr. Magorium's libation station.
Yes. Nice.
Yeah. I can just see him standing on the balcony of his libation station shouting, show me your boobies. Yeah.
Who wants that necklace?
Who as wants he throws that necklace? Beads.
The beads that he's throwing are animated. So this week, I want to start by going backwards. So we're going to go with question three first.
Because it's so zany and whimsical to do it that way.
Wackiness. So, Emily, I really, really liked the Time Lord. He did actually mention in the movie becoming a bee, so I thought that was a clever tie-in. Ben mentioned this, that he doesn't have control of his departure, but not where he ends up in his next life. And I think that's a really interesting way to go about that.
Yeah, sorry. He has control over his departure, but he doesn't have control over his next arrival. Like he kind of just gets transported into being a bee against his will, essentially. So I thought that was really clever. I also like that it had a very Quantum Leap feel to it, where it's like he's leaping and he's hoping his next leap is his leap home. But no,
Emily doesn't get it.
No, I knew she wouldn't.
Connor, I really like yours as well. I think it's hilarious that he's been catering to kids for 243 years and now it's his turn. The libation station last minute was pretty funny, but I don't think was enough to carry the answer. So I'm giving that one to Emily. Question two, which was probably the hardest one. One and two were both very, very hard, but you both had really good tone setting approaches to your answer. Connor, you have an excellent accent, which, you know, that wasn't part of the question, but it did help sell it. And I really liked your logic behind each one of them getting their item, and it seemed to fit the tone of the movie, most specifically the hot dog. Like, that was one of Magorium's, like, key notes that we know about him, and you solved it in his will, and I thought that was really funny. Emily, again, your world setting of making this an audio recording, having some sound effects, the trying to get a kiss in at the end made me laugh a lot. I liked the euphonium. Is that right? Euphonium?
Mm-hmm.
The euphonium, that does feel like it's would be, like, a wacky thing, and then he adds in, oh, maybe like a xylophone, like that felt very stream of thought from Magorium. But I think the other two felt a little short. I don't really remember any doodles. I did like the Captain Hook tie-in, but yeah, I think that Connor's was just a little bit better all around. So that one is going to go to Connor. Finally, back to one. Back to where we started. Thank you, Brian McKnight. I think that's the right person. Is that who sings
it
back
is.
To one?
Yeah, you got it.
Nailed it.
Good one.
It's a song. So for the first one, we had you pick a random movie and put Kermit into it. And both of these made me very, very, very happy. Emily, the Kermit flailing, like even aside from watching you do it, like was a very funny thing to add. And then like actually seeing the puppeteers still having Kermit and Miss Piggy on them. And then the Miss Piggy voice as a zombie was hilarious. The comment of you, hi ho, just because you haven't found your talent yet doesn't mean that you don't have one. Felt more like Mr. Magorium instead of.
That's a literal Kermit quote.
It's straight it's from the 2011 movie.
But still, like, I don't know why he would be saying that to Shaun of the Dead in that.
Because he
moment.
Just fell over off the fence. He didn't leap over the fence.
Yeah, I love that the frog hops over the fence and shames Shaun of the Dead. Anyway, it just felt a little bit less Shaun of the Dead for me. And Connor, for This Is the End, like the whole thing felt like exactly what that entire movie was about. And like that scene, if they had a reason to actually get Kermit in there, which it's a movie about a bunch of superstars, like. It makes sense to go in that movie kind of, but like the way that you wrote him into that scene felt so right for Jay and Craig to toss the toy to get away, because the whole movie they're just trying to kind of like outlive one another. Both really good answers, but it by the split of a hair, I'm going with Connor. So Connor is going to win this one 2-1 this week.
Congratulations.
Nice job.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. I would like very to point out group. That when Mutant shows up to the back room with all the papers and everything, I had to look this up. Sorry that you didn't remember, but Mr. Magorium says, oh yeah, and they're doodles that I've never framed too. So yes, it is something. I always have a reason
sorry,
for my logic, but it's
line.
Okay.
It's not memorable, but it is canon.
No, it was very close. Connor, you were amazing. Thank you so much for being on.
Yeah,
thank absolutely. You for having me. This was a blast.
Yeah, watch out, Ben West. He'll come back and destroy you both.
I encourage it. Seriously, we got to bring you back for Simpsons movie. I think that's
I'd love to,
a done deal. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. It's somehow an even better fit than this movie.
Right.
And a better movie from what I remember.
Yeah,
much better.
All right. Well, one last time, thank you, Connor, for being on the podcast. So why don't you tell us a little bit about your podcast or anything else you'd like to plug?
So the show that I co-host is called No Highway Option. It's a movie podcast similar to this, where we answer the one question that applies to every film ever made. Is it better or worse than Vin Diesel's 2005 masterpiece, The Pacifier? We get movies from our guests and we go through. We have a specific set of criteria. It's a lot of fun. Matt was actually on an episode, depending on when this comes out, either recently or will be in the future, talking about Space Jam. And yeah, we come out on Tuesdays. Our socials are all at No Highway Pod.
All right. So I think it's important then, Connor, is this movie better than The Pacifier?
Good Lord, no.
I was surprised when you said you've only had one movie better than The Pacifier.
I mean, with the group consensus, usually I'm a lot more lenient of like saying a lot movies are better. And then my co-host is like, nothing's as good. Nothing can top it. Nothing can top it. We did Juno a couple weeks ago, and of me, the co-host, and our guest, I was the only one who said it was better. And I was this is much better. What are you talking about?
Wow. Right. I was surprised to hear that number where it was only one, but mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I know listening to your podcast, Connor, I had to go back and watch The Pacifier, and that movie is
pretty good. Something.
It's super weird, but it's fun, man.
It's pretty good. Pretty good.
Also, one I haven't seen. Yeah. Surprise, surprise.
All right. Well, Connor, thank you one more time for being on, and we will have those links in the episode description. And if you guys are still listening, be sure to subscribe, rate, and share. Thank you so much. Next week, we're going to be doing American Gangster with my friend from the internet. Johnny now.
Okay, Jason Bateman.
All right.
Thanks for being on, Connor. It's nice to meet you.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.